Well, welcome everyone, and thank you for joining us in our latest installment of the Meeting of the Minds. It's a discussion series hosted by the National Center for Women in Information Technology, or NCWIT, and the Academic Alliance. Today, our topic is faculty hiring, ensuring diversity, equity, and inclusion from the job description to the offer. And I'm Matt Muchna. I'm the membership coordinator for NCWIT's Academic Alliance. I have the honor of being a co-moderator today, and just briefly for accessibility purposes, I'm going to describe myself. I'm a fair-skinned individual with medium-length light blonde hair, and I'm wearing brown glasses today, and I currently use he, him pronouns. And I'm just going to ask our co-moderator and fellow Academic Alliance team member and NCWIT research scientist, Gretchen Achenbach, for a brief introduction and a self-description as well. Gretchen.
I'm Gretchen Achenbach, as he said, NCWIT research scientist. I am a white woman with brown glasses and longish blondish hair.
Thanks, Gretchen. Just briefly, some background. The NCWIT Academic Alliance is encompassing the post-secondary space. It's a community of over 2,400 individual faculty and staff members from 660 higher ed institutions committed to academic excellence through increasing the number of women, genderqueer, and non-binary individuals in computing. And the Meeting of the Minds discussion was created as a way to share the collective lived experience, the best practices, and some of the challenges that are held in our community across institutions. Today, we will hear from our speakers. We have a fantastic panel for you folks. And then if time allows for it, we'd love to go to some short breakouts to really promote discussion. And then we'll have some question and answer towards the end. So the first, let's say half hour or so of the event, we'll be hearing from our speakers and their perspectives. And then the second half will be group discussion. And as, And as a discussion based event, we invite you all to keep your cameras on, mics on mute, please, unless you're speaking, and place your questions in the chat throughout the session. If we don't get to them during the initial speaker portion, we'll try to address them in the Q&A at the end. So please ask them early and ask them often. We are recording today, and we'll be sharing that recording on our website, ncwit.org, as well as with the registrant list. So let's begin. And as you all are aware, the hiring process is truly a marathon. As many of you have experienced firsthand, hiring faculty in computing and IT can be very challenging, especially when trying to reach beyond majority groups. Our panel of speakers today will dive into the topic by sharing insights, strategies, and best practices from their own unique experiences. And today we have four distinguished speakers to help lead our discussion. I'm going to briefly introduce them here. And to start, Dr. Robyn Sandekian, the Director of Faculty Advancement for the College of Engineering and Applied Science at the University of Colorado, Boulder. In this role, Robyn holds responsibilities. Sorry about that. There we go. Holds responsibilities for all levels of faculty recruiting, hiring, retention, and advancement, including increasing faculty diversity, equity, and inclusion. Next day, we have Dr. Grayson Hunt, the Director of Equity Outreach and Resources in the Office of the Vice Provost for Diversity at the University of Texas at Austin. Grayson uses his experiences as a transgender person and his academic training in feminist philosophy and intersectionality to create DEI workshops for faculty. Most recently, he has developed a two-part diversity workshop for faculty serving on search committees at UT Austin. Next, Dr. Cheryl Swanier, senior teaching faculty at University of Massachusetts Amherst, and leads faculty recruitment workshops through their STRIDE program there. She has a long track record of excellence in research, teaching, and involvement in the broadening participation in computing community. Dr. Swanier is the recipient of both the 2017 NCWIT Seed Fund Award and the NCWIT Undergrad Research Mentoring Award in 2013. And last but certainly not least, Dr. Brianna Blaser, the Associate Director for Access Computing and Access Advance at the University of Washington. Brianna Blaser has a PhD in Women's Studies and a background in diversity and career development in STEM education and careers. Through her work at the DO-IT Center, D-O-IT, all caps, Center, Brianna works to increase the participation of people with disabilities in science and engineering careers. And it was really excited to be a part of pulling this group together. I think we have a great, great panel with tons of rich experience. I'm going to first start with Dr. Sandekian, and I'll ask all the speakers to just briefly describe themselves for accessibility purposes as well. But we'll start with you, Dr. Sandekian. So in your experience leading efforts to diversify the face of faculty and staff in an engineering and applied sciences college at CU Boulder, and from your research conducted in this arena, what are some of the best practices or the key challenges that you would like to bring up as we introduce the topic of faculty hiring today?
Well, thank you, Matt. Thank you so much, everyone, for being here. I'm Robyn Sandekian. I am a fair-skinned white woman, shoulder-length blonde hair. I use she, her pronouns. And I want to thank you all for being here and engaging in this conversation. When we were talking about how to set up this panel, it was exciting for me to be beside these folks because the other three folks are individuals who I use their work quite frequently and as best practices. And also, I want to shout out to Sherry Sanders, who is here from University of Colorado Boulder. So I'm really moving forward based on work that has been done by many folks already in the space. And so I'm going to start this conversation by focusing on general concepts that are important to equitable faculty hiring processes. And then I'm going to leave it to my fellow panelists who will discuss some specifics related to individual affinity groups. So first of all, please understand you're not in this task alone. Like I say, my dissertation work was actually on the experiences of sexual minority engineering faculty members. And it's such a small community that I've come to know almost everyone that I cited. And as I've expanded into faculty diversity roles here, again, the folks that you'll see the resources shared from are many of these folks on this call already. So there are decades of research and practitioner support materials available, some of which will be shared today, others which you can find online or you can ask any of us about. And then from this 10,000 foot view, I want to recognize that the process of creating equitable academic environments can't begin or end with faculty hiring new faculty into your organization, right? You're not, excuse me, we have 350 faculty in the College of Engineering at CU Boulder, and no one individual that we bring in is going to be tasked with or be able to change the culture of our college environment that has existed for 130, 140 years. So it's key that you have an organizational philosophy and the support framework regarding the importance of creating an equitable environment that could eventually lead to a more diverse hiring pool and to the retention of those hired, right? I mean, I think with anything with faculty hiring or any other type of hiring, it's all fine and good if you get them in the door, but if they leave, you know, 2, 3, 4 years later, you're no better off and potentially worse off than you were because you didn't support folks that you did eventually recruit. And so really my 10,000 foot question is your institution ready to use inclusive, accessible, and equitable hiring practices, right? So you may or may not know that. I know that we have individuals from various types of institutions here. And so the answer to that is going to be very different. We, for instance, at CU Boulder had an advanced grant from National Science Foundation for institutional transformation, like in the first or second cohort 20 years ago. We use the materials that University of Michigan created from their advanced grant. We use the Stride Fellows model somewhat. I am the singular Stride Fellow at CU Boulder in a way. So you need to know what's going on your campus as far as hiring strategies, policies, programs, who could be an ally. Is there support at all levels for the work that needs to be done? So at CU Boulder, that means we needed support at a minimum from the departments, individual departments, the college, and campus levels, right? We didn't just one day decide, oh, well, look, we don't have a particularly diverse faculty. We're just gonna, you know, latch on to this idea that we need to change it, and how will we change it? It's really, there are some very deep and awkward conversations sometimes. You need to know where you stand and acknowledge that. So the University of Colorado is a predominantly white institution. Boulder, the city of County of Boulder, is a predominantly white community, very well educated. There is a perception that we honestly believe is earned. That at times in the past, CU has enacted racist policies as far as hiring faculty, staff, and admitting students, right? We don't like to admit that, but we know that that's out there. And so if we go to allies and ask for their help to engage faculty, to get faculty candidates to apply, if we don't acknowledge that information right up front, they're going to ignore us, and they will flat out tell us, there's no way I would try to help you recruit someone to CU Boulder. So again, you have to know and acknowledge where you stand as far as the institution. And then next thing would be, how do people in your institution define success when it comes to diverse faculty hiring, right? So we are really focusing on the fact that we are working to create an inclusive environment. We are not looking to hire diverse folks in and of itself. And I think that the panelists will probably get to hopefully deeper in that discussion, but nobody wants to feel like they were hired because they had this individual identity, right? They want to know that they were hired because they are considered a potentially fantastic faculty member with all of their identities. The other key point is that clear and consistent communication is absolutely vital. We know at CU that we make our offers later than most others, and we've been trying to make that earlier so that folks don't have to sit around and wait for 6 months in the process to find out, oh, they're not even being considered. Or, oh, we would really like to interview you, but we can't interview you till April. And by then they've had, you know, offers from many of the research institutions that are presented or are represented here today. So last but not least, everyone who interacts with a faculty member is responsible for creating an inclusive hiring process. We had some interesting conversations with, we did implicit bias training, we've done many other types of training, and there's always this rub between mandatory training, which NCWIT and our colleagues there are vehemently opposed to because they know all the research about the problems with mandatory. And then we from the other side are like, well, yes, but we can't just, you know, teach implicit bias to the choir. We can't just sing to the choir kind of thing. But so it's important to know that anyone who interacts with the search process is responsible for creating this environment. And So there are key issues that you have to determine at your own institution. So with that, that's sort of the 10,000 foot level. And then I'm going to pass along to my colleagues to provide with some more specifics. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate you opinion in broad strokes. And I know from your years of research, it's not easy to always step back and do that. So I appreciate the work to do that and kick off our panel. Next, I'd like to ask Dr. Grayson Hunt, just in your experience leading these faculty workshops at UT Austin, what are some of your recommendations for this group here today? And how can we go beyond well intentions to actually making structural changes in the hiring process and beyond? And just a quick reminder to please self-describe and pass it to you. Thank you.
Thanks, Matt. Hi, everyone. My name is Grayson Hunt. I've got my pronouns displayed in my window, he, him. I'm a white masculine presenting person with short brown hair. I'm in my early 40s and I'm standing in front of my laptop with my two dogs out of view, unfortunately. So thanks for having me here. I did prepare some slides just so that I could give you a kind of a view of what the materials are that I've been working with. I was hired from within my university at the University of Texas at Austin to create a plan to get faculty engaged with inclusivity practices when thinking about hiring. So if Matt will indulge me, please go to the first slide there. So I'll just talk through this presentation very briefly just to show the kind of main components and see if this is something y'all are doing or not. And just to kind of reiterate what Robyn was saying, like from, you know, it can feel like we're trying to boil the ocean when we're trying to make these shifts. You know, hiring won't be enough, right? We can't do recruitment without retention. And so what I really am trying to do with these workshops, which we have not mandated from the president or provost level, but colleges can choose, deans can choose to mandate it for their colleges, and certain ones have. What we're trying to do is get people in touch with their own context within their colleges, within the university. So in our workshop presentations, I start with like some data and best practices before turning to scenarios that people go into breakout rooms with their committee members and workshop and try to kind of flex their skills, like a kind of what would you do situation. So in the first part of the workshop, we look at who's out there to hire. You know, there's NSF data on who got a PhD in any given year, who's already at our institution. We have data that legal permits us to share with people. And then we look, using Interfolio, who's applying to our university. So an example of what you might see in the workshop, if you go to the next slide, is we pull data from Interfolio. That's the mechanism we use to track our candidate pools. And this is not the cutest slide, but what you'll see is on the left column, 30 non-targeted searches and where they landed. So architecture got one hire, engineering got five, et cetera. And then from all of those 30 hires that we pulled from the data, we had 5,800 applicants, and I demonstrate the demographic breakdown for that group, which includes Hispanic and Latinx people, people with disabilities, veterans. And I include gender divergent because although that's not a state or federally mandated category, you can in Interfolio include, you know, male, female, other, and prefer not to disclose. And so where it's other, people can type in. And so I just put in front of people, you know, how people are using language to identify. And the most common terms in there have been non-binary and transgender, certainly. But we also have intersex people applying, indigenous designations for two-spirit, third gender, et cetera. So I just kind of call that forward so that people kind of know who's applying. And then we can think from there, like, what do we want to be ready for? What do we want to offer given that diversity? So in the next slide, we have some best practices that I share. And first is to run those EEO demographics results through Interfolio. And we have been developing materials so that people can run it not only for the candidate pool at large, but then tagging a long list and a short list, we can look to see where barriers are coming up and for what demographics. So who makes it through to the short list and who doesn't over time. We ask that everybody review the job call before looking at any of the applications, and that the applicants only be compared to the job call and not to one another as a way to kind of reduce the incidence of bias. We also really want to encourage candidates to get to meet with people outside of the committee, and those people they might want to meet could be communities that are identity-based or discipline-based. So we find ways to normalize meeting people outside of the department so that they can kind of learn about the department or about the institution from people who aren't on their committee. So I've been part of several of those kind of meetings where genderqueer and trans people, people with disabilities, those are the communities that I identify with, can meet with me and others to get a sense of what, you know, the climate is like. Okay. And then the final slide, two slides, I believe, in my remaining 30 seconds, if I'm timing correctly, we go into these hypothetical, may or may not have happened, hiring scenarios where the committees are put into breakout rooms with each other. So it's committee specific. And this is a lot of text on the screen, but basically I developed with our diversity officers who represent each college and school of the university, scenarios that felt kind of true to life that had no right or wrong answers, but kind of opened a can of worms in terms of issues. So in one scenario that's quite popular, there's concern about a candidate's vibe. Someone says, look, niceness is not on the job call, and that their research feels kind of flat, according to a junior expert, but a senior person less familiar thinks they're really great, right? So there's power dynamics, there's all sorts of things going on. And as a committee, the people decide what they would do, what the pressing issues are, and then they come back from the breakout rooms and discuss as a whole. So this portion, the second part with these scenarios, is really meant for committee members to speak with each other, frankly, but then also as a larger group of with the other search committees present, just to kind of exercise our skills in disentangling and figuring out what's going on in any given situation, but also figuring out what someone would be prepared and willing to do if they needed to say something. So that's the gist of it. I think that's my last slide too. So I'll leave it there and I will put my email in the chat if anyone wants to reach out. Thanks a lot.
Thank you so much. Next, we'd like to hear a bit from Dr. Cheryl Swanier. And just as a lead-in, I'd like to know from your career and your research in creating more inclusive computing classrooms and your recent work with Stride at UMass Amherst, what advice would you give us all to help us improve diversity and excellence through the faculty hiring process? And if you would just briefly self-describe for accessibility, Dr. Swanier.
So good afternoon, everyone. I am Cheryl Swanier. I'm a computer scientist and I teach computer science at the University of Massachusetts Amherst. I'm a light-skinned Black woman and my pronouns are she, her, and hers. And so can I look at my first slide, please?
You know, Dr. Sonia, I don't think I have them in this deck, unfortunately.
I do, and I can share them.
Oh, that would be terrific.
Okay, let me just get it to the right slide view.
I'm sorry about that. Thanks, Robyn.
So what I want to say about, first of all, I do conduct two-hour trainings at UMass Amherst on faculty searches, and we train all of our faculty, whether you're a part of the search committee or not. And these are like 2-hour trainings. And we've been doing this since 2018. And so I believe that research is an important part of conducting, you know, effective faculty searches. In fact, there is power in diversity in order to enhance the search process itself. And socially and intellectually diverse teams actually, you know, I believe make better decisions when recruiting and hiring new faculty. And so I also believe that research can basically tell you what you need to know about improving the search process today. And so I'm going to briefly go over how to apply these strategies to the various stages in the search process. Here at UMass Amherst, when we train our faculty, we talk about getting great applications from the best applicants, making the right shortlist, and managing the visit and choosing and attracting the candidate. And so I'm going to share with you some of those best practices, but I want you to think about just for a moment, you know, some questions that you want to ask yourself before you actually do the search process. What challenges have you faced with searches in the past, and what are your goals for your current, you know, searches? And I think these questions will help to actually inform the search process and for it to be effective. So let's talk about getting great applications for the best applicants. The truth of the matter is you can't hire the best candidates unless you get them to apply with all the information that you actually need. And so this involves actually taking continuing steps to develop the application pool and crafting an inclusive job ad. So you want to be very intentional about what you include in your job advertisement, and also clearly define and communicate the application components. So when taking steps to develop the application pool, we must be cognizant of the fact that search is a very active word. It's not inactive. And I believe that you should, you know, strongly consider, not only consider diversity, but ensure diversity, because when you do this, you actually widen your pool to those that are at other institutions and doing great jobs. And it's also a good practice to bring young scholars to campus before you actually do the search. And you should also consider focusing your seminar series on this in particular. Also, it's important that you craft an inclusive job ad. And so when you craft this job ad, you want to make sure that you define the position as broadly as possible. You want to make sure that you make an explicit commitment to diversity, and make sure that the language itself is very welcoming. Next slide, please. So stage number two is achieving excellence in diversity in the application shortlist. You want to make sure that, I mean, I know this is a difficult thing to do because you may get so many applications, but you're probably choosing a shortlist from, you know, hundreds of applications. But it's important within your search committee that you build an effective search committee, and time is of the essence when you're trying to hire someone. And so we have to really, you know, think about that. And also this is very important. Point C, work to limit the effects of unconscious bias and evaluate fallacies in your deliberations. As humans, we all have some type of bias, whether it's conscious or unconscious. And we need to be able to recognize individually where our biases are and not to let them influence the decision-making process when hiring for diverse, candidates from diverse backgrounds. And be aware that bias could have affected past evaluation of other, hires as well. Next slide, please. The third stage is managing the visit. I can't emphasize how important it is to manage the visit. You might not get the candidate you want because the visit was a complete failure. You don't want this to happen. Campus visits provide crucial information to both the search committee and the candidate, and they are both a part, of the selection and the recruiting. So provide a welcoming environment. So whoever you choose to host the candidate on the day that you bring your candidate to campus, make sure that the host that you're selecting is someone who has great interpersonal skill. They're very kind, they're very welcoming, because as the cliche goes, first impressions are lasting impressions. Ensure that all candidates, get the information about family-friendly policies from appropriate sources and respect candidates, candidates' privacy. And I know sometimes, we may slip and ask some person like, is your husband coming with you? Well, how many kids do you have? But we know not to do these things, but it's important that we don't do these things. And the last stage is stage four, making the decision. After all candidate visits, gather input promptly, okay? You might want to make sure that you have all the data and you have it in a centralized location so that all the faculty outside of the search committee could, be informed about the candidate that you're interviewing. Postpone or avoid making global rankings or ratings. And lastly, manage full faculty discussions of candidates. Make sure in that call meeting with all faculty present that you have, a lead person for the search committee to facilitate that process. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Swanier. And my apologies about the slides, and thanks to Grayson for hosting them there. Appreciate your perspective and your experience with faculty hiring and really the nuts and bolts of those steps. Really appreciate that. Next, I'd like to welcome Dr. Brianna Blaser. I know this conversation is not new to you. It's one that you've been a part of throughout your career, advocating for disability access and resources. What resources or best practices might you share with this group to ensure accessibility and inclusivity throughout the hiring process? And if you would just briefly describe yourself, Dr. Blaser.
Thank you for having me. I'm excited to be here today and to be talking about this. So my name is Brianna Blaser. I am a white cisgendered woman with brown hair. And you'll see behind me examples of my kids' artwork. It makes me happy, and I hope it makes other people happy too. I'm going to be staring at myself on a box. So we have two projects here at the University of Washington that are thinking about faculty with disabilities and what we need to be doing to better support them. And if you want to go to the next slide. So one of them is the Access Advance project, which is funded to increase the participation of women with disabilities in academic STEM careers. So particularly wanting to provide insight and best practices to folks who are working in the advanced space and other related areas to think about disability and how to integrate some best practices related to disability into their work. I know everybody wants to take an intersectional approach to the work that they are doing these days, but that doesn't always happen, particularly when we start thinking beyond race and gender. The other project that many more of you are probably familiar with is AccessComputing, which is one of the NSF Broadening Participation in Computing Alliances. And we work to increase the participation of people with disabilities in computing education and careers. And AccessComputing is a long-going program for well over 15 years now. And just recently, we started saying, you know, we've spent so long really talking about students with disabilities, and we are graduating more and more PhD students who are going into faculty careers. We need to really increase the amount of conversation that we're having about accommodations and access beyond just students. So those are some conversations that we are having there. And I will just point out, we are a national resource. If you have questions related to disability, whether it's faculty hiring students or another piece, you're welcome to reach out to us. I see that Gretchen put the URLs for our websites in there. You can also email us at accesscomp@uw.edu. So as we've been thinking about these faculty conversations, there's some things that we've been hearing from faculty, if we can just go to the next slide, about their experiences, particularly navigating the hiring process, right? One is making sure that they can ask for accommodations during interviews and that they are given those accommodations, right? And some of the things that you might see pop up are some of the classic things like a sign language interpreter, but it may also be somebody who needs longer breaks throughout the day because of some kind of chronic health condition. It may be somebody that needs a clear schedule ahead of time so they can better prepare themselves. They may need to not walk a ton on campus to get between meetings and be rushed, right? So there could be all kinds of things. But something that I've really heard from a lot of people with disabilities I work with over the years is that when they're going into an environment, even if they request accommodations, say for a visit, nobody's communicating clearly with them to let them know that that's taken care of, to ask them follow-up questions and to really make sure that their needs are met. And you know, Cheryl was saying something about how the culture of an institution can really be conveyed in the context of that campus visit. So again, thinking about making sure that your candidates are comfortable, particularly with regards to their access needs. Some other concerns I've heard by faculty is moving from one institution to another and then being surprised that they aren't able to receive accommodations that they got at their past institution at a future one, or that the policies are different and now their department is supposed to fund that instead of it coming from a central funding organization and the awkwardness that that creates. I've also heard from folks who are seeing antiquated job requirements in ads, right? So these are the things that say you must lift 20 pounds or, you know, you have to be able to sit at a desk for X number of hours. Faculty members don't really need to do that, right? There are other ways to do these things. And recognizing that people with disabilities do things different, just get rid of those. We don't need them in there, right? And the other thing I really wanted to highlight is kind of continued concerns about the pandemic for people who are high risk, right? And this includes many people with disabilities. So things like campus visits, are folks really comfortable traveling right now? What does that mean for them? And I'll say this, you know, I think about it a lot in the context of working with people with disabilities, but I'm a parent of young kids, right? And even myself, as I'm thinking about SIGC coming up next month, I haven't had consistent childcare because of childcare outages because of pandemic exposures, right? I don't want to travel right now because I don't want to put all that on my husband if we all of a sudden don't have childcare for a week, right? So just the implications related to that. These are some of the things that I'm hearing from faculty. Oh, I'm trying to go to the next slide, but I can't. So we're really trying to think a little bit more about systemic change, right? So how do institutions think about their practices and reflect on what they're doing to do better, right? And so some of this is thinking about the hiring and onboarding process, right? Are hiring committees familiar with responding to accommodation requests? How do they meet those needs? Do they know where those resources come from? Do they know how to communicate with people with disabilities? Is the online application accessible, right? This is another thing we hear from people, is that they're going to apply to jobs and a website isn't accessible. How does your university do accessibility reviews, looking at accessibility guidelines to make sure that things are accessible? Are potential hires and new faculties aware of the accommodation process? Do they learn about those policies? Are they given resources related to disability in the context of the interview process? And then is this process clearly documented, right? So that they can know what's coming or how they need to go about these things. And just, I think I have one more slide. And again, this process doesn't end once they get to campus, right? If they get to campus and things are not going well, they're not gonna stay, right? So, you know, thinking more broadly, are campus or departmental DEI initiatives addressing disability more than just mentioning it, right? Is there really a substantive commitment to considering disability? Are you thinking about accessibility in procurement? So particularly over the last couple of years, we have talked to so many people and partners that have procured technology that is not accessible, and that's led to issues. Our physical environments and other things that you're procuring accessible as well, right? Another big concern that we hear from people with disabilities is that the need to not look like they are a burden to their department because of funding for accommodations. Is this coming from centralized funding? Is it coming from the department? And then moreover, how onerous is the documentation and approval process for getting those accommodations? There's an incredible amount of work that goes into it on the behalf of people with disabilities a lot of times to get what they need. And then finally, the other thing to think about as further down the line is how disability-related impacts on productivity are considered in the context of things like promotion and tenure, right? If you're unable to travel as often and aren't going to as many conferences, if it takes you longer to do things and that impacts your publication record, how is that being considered further down the line? So just some food for thought. We have more resources related to this on our website. And like I said, we're always happy to be a resource as well.
Thanks, Brianna. I'd love to move us into some short breakout room discussions. If folks are willing and able, I have some rooms set up and we have a document for shared note-taking and some discussion prompts there if your group needs any help, which I don't think there will be much need. I'm sure you all have many questions and challenges that you've faced in this, but we're gonna do a short, I wouldn't say 10-minute breakout room. I encourage everyone to introduce themselves in the chat, include the pronunciation of your name and pronoun to help people accurately address you. And we also would just ask everyone to help us in creating a shared safe space, one that's inclusive, one that shares the mic, and we invite you all to help us take notes and share resources with your corresponding breakout room. So I'm gonna share that shared Google slide deck. And once you go into your room, find the room number that you're in and find the corresponding slide. And you can use that slide to take notes, and I'll bring everyone back in just 10 minutes. So enjoy and see you shortly. Welcome back, everyone. Pull us back. I know it's always a short time. We had one group finish early, which is encouraging. I think they came up with some good solutions. But would love to just spend a few moments briefly, just any burning questions from folks, or were there common themes or challenges that emerged from the different groups or helpful resources that came up? Anyone like to share?
I'll share a little bit from group one, in that more we basically discussed again, although there are some geographic differences potentially with the physical location of an institution, we all have sort of the same problems. There are concerns about laws at local and state level as they impact potential candidates, parenting. Some faculty have kids. And as Brianna was saying, the endemic situation now is by no means over as far as parents all of a sudden having their kids to take care of when they thought that they had that covered. And what do you do about that? And then just literally, how do you get enough applicants for positions, whether those be faculty or staff, in high demand areas such as computing science? Where industry is a competitor, right? And typically a better hired or better paying competitor. So how do you deal with those? So we sort of just came up with more questions than answers.
That's the place to start. But anyone else like to share from their group?
In our group, we talked a little bit about finding places to connect with graduate students from diverse backgrounds. So thinking about things like the Tapia celebration. And you know, the bonus is whoever gets to go to connect with those students is also hopefully learning about what folks are sharing there and gaining some of that knowledge. Also the CRAWP grad cohort workshops are another good place to connect with folks.
Thanks, yeah. Anyone else like to share or anyone have a question or something they felt, a lingering question that wasn't addressed or a challenge you're running into?
I think one thing that came up in our group, it was interesting, some of the differences that you may have between a large institution and a small institution. So at a small institution, at this particular one, where the movement towards considering diversity and bias and so forth in hiring is coming at the institutional level rather than, say, at a large university where some of these might be done more at a college and a departmental level. So it's a more like an across the institution, and it seems to be going well at this particular institution, but I guess I could see where it might also present some challenges when you have different, like the concerns in computing or engineering fields might be different than in other fields. So those need to be taken into account. And I think the other thing that came up in our group is the difficulty of when you really get down to the hiring process where there's, you're considering diversity and so forth, and in the end it's merit that comes out as the final deciding, or what they're considering to be merit. The challenge.
And Gretchen, do you know of a way to avoid that from happening? I mean, it seems like it's such a common outcome. Is there a way, adjusting the matrix, or you know, maybe ranking on more than one point of diversity, or having applicants, you know, write a diversity statement as a part of the application? Yeah. What are some possible ways to avoid that?
I think one that was mentioned in our somewhere in what we were doing today is like making sure that you're comparing what you're hiring for to what you were advertising for, you know, what your original standards were, and not so much comparing candidates to each other. I forget which one of our speakers it was that said that. But then also, if it's really important to you to create a diverse and inclusive department, then that really does need to be a part of your hiring criteria. And I was hoping to, I know we're almost out of time because I would have loved to have heard what our panelists had to say about this, but just thinking when you're hiring, not only about hiring a person because they have, because of their identity, but also considering even if they don't represent a diverse identity that you're trying to include, but that they are welcoming themselves and, you know, place priority on diversity and inclusion themselves, so that you can, you know, something about that, like creating the environment in your department that you need in order to be able to bring in people from diverse backgrounds is really important. And that often that needs to be created by the people who are already there, or who are not from those, may not be themselves from those diverse backgrounds. So it does seem that that's a really important thing. And I think that, you know, hearing in the future, like how I was hoping to ask somebody about how you include that in your job search, that how you evaluate that commitment to diversity and inclusion in your candidates.
Thanks Gretchen. I think we had a feeling this would happen. There'd be more questions than time for answers. We want to encourage folks to join or participate and continue the discussion on our higher ed listserv. Maybe Gretchen, if you don't mind posing that question, and maybe we can get a thread going, because I think it's incredibly valuable. The listserv is open and free to any individual at an NCWIT Academic Alliance institution. If you're not sure, or you have any trouble signing up, just reach out to me, matt.muchna@ncwit.org. And lastly, we will share out a short evaluation survey and appreciate comments there as we continue to evolve and make these events worthwhile for this community. But I'd really like to thank our speakers for volunteering today and sharing their time and expertise with us. It was really insightful and I really appreciate their time. Also co-moderator Gretchen Achenbach for your help and the rest of the Academic Alliance team and the NCWIT communications team really helped get the word out for this event. So thank you all. I really appreciated this time. I wish we had a whole day because there's so much more here, but let's keep the conversation going on the higher ed listserv and look forward to talking with you all in the near future. So be safe, take care, and be well, everyone.
Thanks, everybody.